Buenas tardes.
Good afternoon, colleagues, distinguished delegation of the Republic of Korea, observers, members of civil society, conference services, interpreters, good afternoon to all of you. I declare meeting 3210 of the Human Rights Committee open. In this meeting, we'll be reviewing the fourth periodic report of the Republic of Korea. I'd like to wish a very warm welcome to Mr. Kim Jo-hyun, the head of delegation. Your Excellency, you are the Vice Minister of the Ministry of Justice. And I also would like to welcome this very impressive delegation that is here with us, extremely large, with many people here, and I'm sure that this will allow us to have an interactive dialogue that is very high quality, which will allow us to look fully into the questions and concerns that will be raised by the Human Rights Committee. Without further delay, I will give the floor to Your Excellency Mr. Kim to give your initial opening statement, and then we will move on to examine the first section of the list of issues. Mr. Kim, you have the floor.
Mr. Chair, distinguished members of the Human Rights Committee, on behalf of the Republic of Korea, I am honored to have the committee review our fourth periodic report that was submitted in August 2013 in accordance with the Article 40 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights is the humanity's pledge for basic and universal human rights. I would like to extend my admiration to the Human Rights Committee for their work over the past 40 years in monitoring the implementation of the covenant, as well as for advancing the spirit and the principles of the covenant. The Korean government is well aware of the importance of this review of the fourth periodic report since this opportunity came in 9 years. Our delegation, with 39 experts, has gone to great lengths to prepare for this review. And we promise to commit wholeheartedly to this process. Korea has taken the recommendations of the committee very seriously. During the 9 years since the committee's review of our third periodic report in 2006, the Republic of Korea endeavored to incorporate the committee's recommendations. To that end, we have implemented a wide variety of policies to improve individual human rights in Korea. Moreover, we highly value the constructive criticism and advice of the National Human Rights Committee, for it has greatly helped our government pursue balanced human rights policies. We also think the concerns and activities of NGO personnel have been meaningful. Mr. Chair, distinguished members of the Human Rights Committee, after the review of Korea's third periodic report in 2006, the human rights status of Korea has been greatly changing and developing. On the basis of outstanding information and communications technology, all citizens have unlimited access to information on the internet, and conventional media outlets such as broadcasting companies and newspaper agencies have expanded the range of their activities. Thorough monitoring is done to prevent any human rights violations that may arise from such information and communications development through the press and social media. The Korean government, with the goals of becoming a transparent government, has actively disclosed much information and collected public opinions. While encouraging citizens' participation in policy decision-making procedures, including private sector experts, citizens have freely accessed government's human rights policy information and have actively voiced their opinions. The government, through public debate, has been achieving a virtuous cycle of reaching social consensus. The courts and the Constitutional Court, with their independence thoroughly guaranteed, consider human rights as their utmost value. Human rights violations could be subject to judicial review without exception, and the Constitutional Court continues to set legal standards that serve as norms for everyday lives by accumulating rulings in favor of human rights protection for the past 9 years. Even in the National Assembly, countless bills for the promotion of human rights are being submitted, and on this basis, the civil society has expressed various opinions, allowing in-depth examination and discussions. The government is also putting efforts into enacting or revising legislations on matters where national consensus has been reached through strict and sound legislative procedures. Through such pluralistic human rights circumstances, the Korean government is establishing and implementing balanced human rights policies reflecting diverse public opinions. Moreover, the government has extensively researched and is putting various other efforts to implement the recommendations of the Human Rights Committee and other international human rights organizations. Korea's fourth periodic report explains, in order of the Articles of the Covenant, detailed legislative, administrative, and judicial measures taken to implement the contents of the covenant between 2006 through 2010. The contents of the previous periodic reports and circumstances of those periods are referred to when deemed necessary. In particular, I would like to use this opportunity to explain briefly the improvements made in each area of civil and political rights, focusing mainly on the circumstances following the submission of the fourth periodic report. Please refer to the handouts on the efforts of the Republic of Korea to promote human rights from 2011 to 2015. The Korean government's second national action plan was implemented in 2012, and after reflecting the results of the second universal periodic review, Korea initiated the 2013 amended national action plan. The Korean government, through national action plans, selects projects based on the recommendations of international human rights bodies in order to ensure that the committee's recommendations are followed. Since 2013, Korea implemented a review procedure conducted by an evaluation committee comprised of experts in each field, NGO personnel, and scholars. The review procedures reflect the opinions of the panel members in the NAP. In order to improve overall basic human rights, the Social Welfare Service Act was amended in 2012. Accordingly, respect of human rights, including non-discrimination, was established as the utmost value regarding all social welfare services provided by the government, and the government is mandated to provide human rights education for social service providers. In Korea, education on international human rights principles was strengthened so that international human rights treaties can be invoked during judicial procedures such as court proceedings. The Supreme Court in December 2014 translated and published in Korean the OHCHR's professional training material, Human Rights and the Administration of Justice. The Korean Supreme Court has ever since continuously researched and promoted human rights through seminars and other educational methods. Regarding prohibition of discrimination, Article 11 in the Korean Constitution defines equal rights as a basic right, and accordingly, more than 90 legislations prohibit discrimination on the basis of ethnicity, disability, age, sex, and skin color. We have also rectified human rights protection of persons with disabilities and foreigners, areas that were criticized for being inadequate in the past. In 2007, the government laid the foundation for the rights of disabled persons by enacting the Anti-Discrimination Against and Remedies for Persons with Disabilities Act. Moreover, the government has improved the legal system by enacting laws such as the Act on Activity Assistance Services for Persons with Disabilities and the Act on the Support of Welfare of Children with Disabilities and Disability Pension Act to assist disabled persons in Korea to become socially and financially independent. As the number of immigrants steadily increased, the Korean government implemented the first basic plan for immigration policy in 2008. The second plan took effect in 2013 with the policy goal of prohibiting discrimination and having respect for cultural diversity. Furthermore, in 2012, the Korean government, as the first in Asia, enacted the Refugee Act, which covers refugee status determination procedures and treatment of refugees. As a result, the Korean government has provided those recognized as refugees with social security benefits and basic livelihood security equivalent to those given to Korean nationals. The Korean government has also guaranteed foreigners' children education at both primary and secondary educational levels, and also for refugee applicants, Korea has provided living support and education to assist their adaptation to life in Korea. We would like to now talk about measures against violence toward women and children. In regards to the rights of women and children, the Korean government has taken stronger actions against violations rising from domestic violence, sexual violence, as well as child abuse and neglect. While the Korean government has increased the statutory punishment for such violations, non-punitive measures such as protection for victims and educational and corrective treatments for perpetrators have been implemented in order to prevent violence against women and children.
Now we would like to present on capital punishment in regards to the right to life. Korea has not executed capital punishment since 1997, although Korea has been categorized as a state that has abolished the death penalty in practice, capital punishment still remains as a form of statutory punishment. And sharp differences of opinions exist among proponents and opponents. As such, it is difficult to immediately abolish the death penalty in Korea. In regards to human trafficking, the Korean government is proceeding with the ratification procedure for the United Nations Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime and its three supplemental protocols. In order to ratify the Palermo Protocol, the government amended its Criminal Act in April of 2013 in order to establish a general provision against human trafficking. These amendments added clauses on purposes of sex trafficking, sexual exploitation, and organ harvesting, as well as establishing universal jurisdiction provisions. The bill for the ratification passed the National Assembly in May 2015, and only the final depositing of the ratification instruments remains. Next, I would like to present on the prohibition of arbitrary detention, treatment of detainees, and guaranteeing of human rights in criminal procedures. Some say that the rights of prisoners are indicative of a nation's human rights standard. The rights of Korea's prisoners have significantly improved. Recently, the Korean government implemented treatment programs customized to each prisoner. In particular, juvenile inmates are especially treated according to their age and aptitude. Moreover, female inmates are now required to have regular medical checkups regarding gynecological health, in addition to the regular medical examinations. Starting from April 2013, an online video visitation system was implemented to guarantee the right to visit of prisoners by enabling faraway family members and friends, as well as the old, infirm, and disabled acquaintances to visit incarcerated inmates via the internet. Furthermore, in addition to the Habeas Corpus Act that was enacted to prevent arbitrary detention in mental institutions, the government plans to add legal provisions that would establish the officers for habeas corpus to inspect the facilities and file an application for personal relief through prosecutors when illegal accommodation is uncovered. In May 2011, the Criminal Compensation Act was amended as the Act on Criminal Compensation and Restoration of Impaired Reputation, so that the minimum amount of criminal compensation was raised, and this was to ensure appropriate monetary compensation for victims. Also, the time period during which monetary compensation can be claimed for persons who are found not guilty was lengthened, in order to increase the likelihood of financial relief. Furthermore, when a person's reputation is impaired for criminal indictment but is later found not guilty, the person's acquittal is posted on the Ministry of Justice's website to promote the restoration of his or her reputation in their communities. The Korean government is also working hard to protect the rights of crime victims by helping them overcome any physical damages or emotional trauma that they suffered from the crime and to support their return to society. In addition, the Crime Victims Protection Act was amended. It now stipulates that crime victims be informed of their rights under the relevant laws. Recently, the government implemented a real-time emergency monitoring system for victims by distributing emergency pagers in the form of wristwatches to protect crime victims from retaliatory crimes. Now, let me address the right to privacy. The government enacted the Personal Information Protection Act in 2011 and established the Personal Information Protection Commission to ensure privacy invasion relief by seeing to it that personal information in the internet age are protected and that such protective measures and security standards are set throughout the Korean society. In light of the increasing illegal use of stolen resident registration numbers in Korea, in August 2014, the government prohibited the use of those numbers except in the cases of taxation or when necessitated by legislation. The government expects to further safeguard personal information by implementing the Personal Information Impact Evaluation Plan in 2016. This plan will prevent personal information infringement by amending the 2015 Personal Information Protection Act. The Republic of Korea has been in confrontation with the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, DPRK, for over 60 years since the armistice agreement that ended the Korean War. The DPRK has continuously and even recently threatened our national security. As such, the National Security Act is needed to protect the existence, security, and the basic order of liberal democracy of the Republic of Korea, which is in direct confrontation with the DPRK. As with the rulings of the Constitutional Court and the Supreme Court, Article 7 is to be strictly interpreted to apply only when there is a clear risk of actual harm to the basic order of liberal democracy. And therefore, there is hardly ever the case where the National Security Act is abused in Korea. In 2012, the Public Official Election Act was amended. This amendment expanded the right to freedom of expression and political rights by eliminating limits on the period of internet campaigning and other information network systems used during election campaigns. On the other hand, an online identity verification system in Information and Telecommunications Act was enforced in 2007 in order to prevent human rights violations of others by concealing one's own identity. However, in August of 2012, the Constitutional Court ruled that such enforcement was unconstitutional, and subsequently, we abolished the system. Likewise, in 2014, the Constitutional Court ruled that all legal provisions that limited the right to election of convicts and persons whose criminal sentences are suspended from execution were unconstitutional, in that they violated individuals' political rights. Accordingly, amendments to the election law were made to allow convicts sentenced to less than a year in prison and persons whose criminal sentences are suspended from execution to exercise the right to election without any limitations. Mr. Chair, distinguished members of the Human Rights Committee, the Republic of Korea, through unprecedented social and economic development, often dubbed as the miracle on the Han River, has reached its current high level of human rights through the sacrifices and efforts of many citizens. Korea is well aware that the promotion and protection of human rights are of utmost importance to humanity and that it is a value that should be recognized universally. We sincerely hope that through this review today, we will be able to discuss constructively on our human rights status. On this basis, by upholding human rights as the core value in our society, we will commit ourselves to carrying out continuously our role and responsibility in promoting world peace and human rights. Last but not least, I would like to extend my admiration and respect to all who are working towards building a better future for humankind, a world in which human rights are enjoyed by all individuals. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kim. Thank you for that introduction that you gave to us, which fills out the report that you submitted and the replies to the list of issues that you sent through to the committee in a timely fashion. We will now begin with the statements from the committee members who have comments and questions to raise. First of all, we will look at issues 1 to 13. This will be the program of work for this afternoon, and normally how we work is have the comments from the committee members, then a break so that the delegation can prepare their replies, and then following the replies there may be follow-up questions. So with no further ado, I will give the floor to the colleagues who have requested to speak. The first on my list is Sir Nigel Rodley. Sir Nigel, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for giving me the floor, sir, and through you, I'd like to express a strong welcome on behalf of the committee to the very strong delegation that we have here and that we're confident we'll be able to present authoritative responses to our questions, authoritative information for us to understand better the report and nature of Korea's compliance with its obligations under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. In my case, it's a question of welcoming the delegation back. I was around last time. I'm not sure if too many of my colleagues were, if any. One of the first things I note, and this was acknowledged by the distinguished head of the delegation in his introduction, is that the report actually covers the period up until 2010, which, even though it was submitted 3 years late in 2013, and still only covered till 2010, and that creates some difficulties for us. I see right now that some supplementary information referred to by the head of delegation has been circulated in largely tabular form, and no doubt that will help us as we go along to get a more up-to-date picture of the situation. The actual written replies gave a limited amount of updating, but hopefully with the new information, with the information we'll get from the dialogue, and information which, as the chair will mention from time to time, can be submitted within 48 hours of the conclusion of the dialogue, the situation will be rectified. And let me just say, by way of background, that the members of the committee do have a sense of where what's going on in the world, and we're certainly sensitive enough to know of the existence of the real tensions that exist in the peninsula, tensions that go back to a war that even I was barely old enough to understand when it was going on. I'm going to, in this round of questioning, in this first phase of questioning, deal with issues 1, 2, and 11. And then I'll come back on some other issues when we get to the second cluster. Issue 1, first of all, the question of the reservation to Article 22 on freedom of association. And I note the explanation of the State Party that essentially what's at issue is that senior civil servants may be in the position of being analogous to employers, therefore engaged in policy making, therefore somehow not susceptible to being unionized or being involved in union activities. In fact, that may be true for civil servants in many parts of the world, and it's certainly not clear to me what is special about the Republic of Korea that makes it necessary to have a reservation for such a particularly specific issue. After all, the covenant doesn't prohibit some limitations on union activities, including the right to strike, under certain circumstances. We would probably interpret Article 22 consistently with international labor treaties, for example, international labor conventions. And in fact, of course, the reservation is not so limited. The reservation is limited to whatever is in the constitution and law of the Republic of Korea. Now, that seems to be saying that we'll comply with Article 22 to the extent that we comply with Article 22, which, of course, is a very broad and vague reservation, and it's potentially a reservation that could be held to be void and invalid for vagueness. We'll come back to issues relating to freedom of association when we get to issue 27, but the delegation should not be surprised if the committee take some convincing by the delegation of the legitimate need to maintain the reservation to Article 22, particularly in its present form. Still on issue one and the question of the implementation of the views of the committee. The response, the replies of the delegation address the issue of the fact that the views don't have direct legal effect in the state party, and that's fine, that's not entirely abnormal. But the question raised in the list of issues was not about direct legal effect, it was about what institutional and legislative measures, in quotes, are taken by the state party to give effect to the views. I note with pleasure on behalf of the committee that the author of Communication 1908/2009 has been granted a legitimate visa to stay in the country, thereby implementing the committee's views in that particular case. Regrettably, however, all the others, which deal with issues of conscientious objection, have not been implemented. And I take it from the reply of the state party that there is no intention of implementing them. The issue of conscientious objection will be the subject of discussion under issue 21, I don't think we need to go into the substance of it until we get to issue 21. There remains the hanging issue, the pendent issue of the status of the views of this committee when it adopts those views under the optional protocol, and the nature of the state party's respect for the optional protocol. Issue two, this is the National Human Rights Institution. We note that the subcommittee of the International Coordinating Committee has deferred confirmation some three times now. Confirmation of the previously granted A status to the NHRCK, National Human Rights Commission of Korea. The government in its responses acknowledges the problem, which is essentially the lack of provision to enable a clear, transparent, and participatory process for the selection of commission members, as well as the need for measures of guarantee of their independence. But regrettably, the reply fails to respond directly. The response deals with the measures that have been taken by the Commission itself to develop solutions to these problems, measures that we've been informed about directly also by the Commission, but in the end it's an issue for the state party, its government, its legislature, to implement the proposals that are necessary to give effect to the concerns, to respond effectively to the concerns of the subcommittee and of the Commission in question. Now, the replies of the government say that the proposals of the Commission are under review by various ministries. In fact, I gather from the Commission itself that the bill has since been submitted to Parliament. I don't know if that's correct, but I'd be glad for to have some clarification of what the status is of proposed measures respond to the concerns of the ICC and its subcommittee, of the Commission itself, so as to resolve that problem. I do note that already apparently the Commission had adopted a public line of announcing vacancies. I don't know if that has been implemented, in particular whether it was followed in the recent report, the recent appointment of a chairperson. Meanwhile, more on issues of substance, I note that the report gives some quite useful information about the National Human Rights Commission of Korea and its handling of complaints from 2004 to 2010. But it stops in 2010. And at a quick thumb through the supplementary materials provided just now at the beginning of the session, I don't see any rectification of that really rather important gap. And while it's even that information is not without interest, it would greatly facilitate the work if it were more up to date, the committee's work if it were more up to date. As the report notes in paragraph 20, complaints of discrimination and human rights violations have been steadily on the rise. Has the trend continued? What are the figures? Why the trend? Why are only a small fraction accepted? It looked to me in relation, for example, to complaints about the police, and I'm not a great mathematician, that about one complaint in 16 is upheld. It'd be interesting if the state party could, the delegation could respond a little on those issues. And then finally, though not quite so finally, turning to issue 11, the issue of torture and treatment of prisoners. First of all, the question of whether of a definition of torture. While the covenant doesn't require that a particular definition be adopted, it certainly does require that all elements of what would be internationally recognizable as torture, and for that we'd be guided by Article 1 of the Convention Against Torture, is in fact effectively reflected in the state party's law. And it's certainly been put to the committee, for example, that this is not the case, that existing law does not, for example, include cover mental torture as a serious crime. If that's wrong, I'd be very grateful to have it corrected, and if it's not wrong, I'd be very grateful to know what measures can be taken to amend the law to ensure that it is really in compliance with the international definition, including the availability of remedies commensurate with the punishment commensurate with the gravity of the offence, and appropriately extended statutory limitation periods. There is, on another issue, the question of complaints of torture and ill treatment, notably in police detention. It's not clear to me from the information we have exactly as to how they're investigated. If I've understood correctly from paragraph 28 of the replies of the state party, the main organ for doing so is the National Human Rights Commission. But as I've indicated, there are no statistics given by the state party or the commission itself on this issue at all. And as I've indicated, even police complaints generally only cover up to 2010. And I looked at the replies of the state party, and they, which address our issue 11, and for some reason let me restate that. I looked at the report of the commission addressed to this committee on that issue, and the Commission confines itself to addressing issues of ill treatment in correctional institutions, but doesn't address the issue of police ill treatment. The State Party offers information according to which there are, of course, disciplinary proceedings that the police themselves undertake, and this is normal and appropriate. According to the information provided by the State Party in its replies, there was one disciplinary case for acts of violence by the police in each of 2012, 2013, 2014, and two prosecutions in 2011, and one in each year of 2012 and 2015. This, I suppose, could be pretty encouraging if it represented a true reflection of the low incidence of the practice of torture or ill treatment. However, according to non-governmental organizations, based on information a Korean MP seems to have obtained from prosecutors' offices, the numbers of complaints of police violence were rather high, 992 in 2011, 904 in 2012, 1,028 in 2013, and 617 in the first half of 2014. I'd be interested to know what the explanation for the discrepancy between the number of complaints and the low number of apparent action, since only 0.2% led to indictments. Does that really mean that 99.8% were invented complaints? I have to say that that wouldn't entirely conform to personal experience I myself have had around the world working in this area. On the issue of treatment of persons in correctional institutions, most cases, according to information provided by civil society, although based on official information as I understand it, involve solitary confinement. I note the State Party's point in its replies of the role of medical supervision in the imposition of solitary confinement. I don't know if the State Party's considered whether the involvement of doctors, medical personnel, in that function doesn't raise ethical issues for them on the basis of codes adopted by international medical bodies such as the World Medical Association. Is there a time limit for sentences of solitary confinement? Is it true that the body that imposes solitary confinement, which has external members apparently, is it true that those members are actually appointed by the prison warden? And if so, how does the State Party explain how that would guarantee the independence of the body? And finally, and I mean finally, for this round, Mr. Chairperson, the issue of protective devices that may be imposed and that were raised by our issue 11. According to the replies of the State Party, apparently the law is clear that those protective devices are protective. They may not be used as a punishment. And yet, and this is a situation we find ourselves in with from time to time, civil society says that they are used as a punishment. It's very hard from the outside to try and unravel what the reality is. If there is an official restriction on the use, that it's for protection and not for punishment, how is it enforced? is it true, as asserted by civil society, for example, that decisions on the use of such devices are within the decision of the prison guard in question? Is there any supervision of those decisions? Is there any review of those decisions? Is there any appeal from those decisions? It would be interesting to know how the state party can ensure that the restriction it imposes on the use, by law, apparently, of such protective devices is in fact applied in such a way that they conform to the law rather than violate the law. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Look forward to the delegation's responses.
Thank you very much, Sir Nigel. The next speaker on my list is Mr. Iwasawa. I give the floor. Mr. Iwasawa, you have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. I join my colleagues in extending a very warm welcome to the distinguished delegation of the Republic of Korea, consisting of a number of qualified persons from relevant government ministries. This afternoon, I would like to ask some questions on issues numbers 3, and then 6, 7, and 8. Since I'm covering 4 issues, Mr. Chairperson, I hope that you will allow me to speak a bit longer. I start with issue number 3 on the constitutional and legal framework with regard to businesses to ensure that they respect the human rights standards under the covenant. We appreciate the replies given by the state party regarding the possibility of attributing responsibility of corporations involved in human rights violations that occur in the course of their overseas operations. We thank the state party in particular for the information given as to the measures taken by the state party concerning the forced labor by the Korea Minting Security Printing and ID Card Operation Corporation, COMSCO, and Daewoo International in the cotton sector in Uzbekistan, and the human rights abuses by POSCO against the project-affected communities in India. These measures, however, are criticized by the civil societies as inadequate. Could the distinguished delegation please comment on the criticism? And in addition to these cases, we have received information on alleged abuse of crews on the Korean-flagged fishing vessels. Could you please comment on this case as well? And could you please explain in a general manner what measures have been taken to provide effective remedies to the victims of human rights violations committed by businesses based in the state party? We welcome the efforts of the government of the Republic of Korea in installing a national contact point, NCP, and using the arbitration committee to educate companies about their social responsibilities. However, according to information before us, the NCP seems not effective in resolving human rights violations, and its independence has been questioned. Could the distinguished delegation explain the ACP's role in implementing the OECD guideline and tell us whether measures have been taken to guarantee the independence of NCP? The state party stated that COMSCO has been promoting cooperation with the World Bank since 2015. However, civil societies take the view that such cooperation can hardly be considered as efforts to eradicate the practice of forced labor. Could the distinguished delegation please explain how such cooperation addresses labor rights issues in Uzbekistan? The written replies to the list of issues state that the state party currently has no plans to adopt a separate law to regulate the activities of corporations regarding human rights standards. Could the distinguished delegation tell us whether the government is willing to consider adopting a legislative framework or a national action plan regulating activities of all businesses domiciled in the state party to respect government rights outside its territory. Is the state party prepared to consider reforms of civil law or any other laws to regulate the activities of corporations regarding human rights standards? Is the state party prepared to consider reforms of civil law or criminal law so that it may provide practical reliefs to damages caused by human rights violations committed by business enterprises of the state party abroad? Is the state party prepared to use trade agreements and national legislation to ensure that imported products are not made with forced or child labor? What do you think about the idea of incorporating human rights assessments into the overseas investment scheme as a prerequisite prior to the negotiation and conclusion of a free trade agreement? I now turn to issue number 6 on discrimination. First, with regard to unwed mothers, we take note of the efforts made by the state party in providing welfare facilities and subsidies. However, according to information we have, the government budget for single mothers is still inadequate. Adoptive parents receive more stipends than single mothers who keep their kids. And among unwed mothers who are still students, 67% dropped out of school due to pregnancy. Could the distinguished delegation please respond and explain what measures have been taken to address the issue of unwed mothers? Now, with regard to LGBTI persons, we have received reports that public officials and government departments have openly adopted anti-LGBT attitudes, and that the new sex education guidelines have been instituted in February without mentioning homosexuality. Could the distinguished delegation please elaborate upon measures that are being taken to combat discrimination against LGBTI persons? Does the state party plan to eradicate discrimination against same-sex people attracted persons in the military and to legalize consensual same-sex sexual activity in the military by repealing Article 22.6 of the Military Criminal Act? With regard to a change of gender, legal gender, could the distinguished delegation explain whether the state party is prepared to take steps to ensure that individuals can obtain legal recognition of their gender without discrimination, such as absent of reproductive ability, absent of underage children and state of being unmarried, etc., all of which are proposed in the Supreme Court's guidelines? Now I turn to issue number 7 on equality between men and women. We thank the state party for providing us with information on the measures taken to support all foreigners married to Korean nationals. While marriage migrants have been allowed to maintain dual citizenship since 2012, when a Korean spouse dies or divorce is obtained, and the grounds provided for in Article 6 of the Nationality Act, the marriage migrant may not apply for dual citizenship and must select a single citizenship. Could you please explain the reason for this restriction for dual citizenship? According to Article 25.2 of the Immigration Control Act, marriage migrants abused by Korean spouses are granted an extension to stay until a remedy process is completed. Could you please tell us whether measures have been taken to mitigate the requirements of naturalization for victims of domestic violence? We thank the State Party for providing us with information indicating its efforts in enhancing women's representation in high-level positions. We take note that the State Party established a gender quota system for local legislatures, and that as a result, the number of women in local councils increased in the 2000s. We take note, however, that the proportion of women at managerial positions is still low in both the public and private sectors. Could the distinguished delegation explain what measures the State Party intends to take to increase female participation in high-level positions? In the report, the State Party explained that the childbirth and rearing were primary reasons for women's low rate in labor force and their high rate in non-regular work positions, which in turn generate gender gaps in wages. However, civil societies have claimed that the male-dominant office culture and the perception that childbearing is a woman's responsibility are the primary causes for women's career interruption. I'm afraid in Japan also that the gender biased perception of women's role persists. And it seems to me that this perception is rather strong in the Korean society. How does the State Party intend to address this problem? I now turn to issue number 8 on violence against women and children. First, marital rape. The State Party relied upon the court judgment of May 2013 to suggest that marital rape is now recognized as a crime of rape through case law. However, cases in which maritime rape was recognized as rape by the court are only a few. Does the State Party have plans to criminalize marital rape in legislation instead of relying upon case law? The level of physical violence and threats required by the court in its case law seems to be severer than that of a usual case of rape. The CEDAW committee recommended the State Party to define maritime rape on the basis of lack of consent of the wife instead of level of physical violence. Could the distinguished delegation comment on this recommendation? Next, I'd like to take up the issue of violence against children. According to information put to us, local child protection agencies are limited in number with insufficient resources, and the provision of rehabilitative support for victims remains inadequate. Despite heavier punishment for sexual crimes against children, the percentage of rape victims under the age of 20 is still high. While the Minister of Justice advocates for reinforcing prosecution of perpetrators of acts of violence and abuse against children, the percentage of cases in which probation is given has actually increased. Could the distinguished delegation please respond and explain in particular why cases of probation have increased? Thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
Thank you very much, Mr. Iwaseva. Now I turn the floor to Ms. Margot Waterfall. You have the floor, madam.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let me also extend my warm welcome to the distinguished delegation of Korea. I'm going to ask questions on issues number 4 and 5. But I have to say that some of the questions were already asked by my colleague, Mr. Iwasawa, so I'm not going to repeat those questions. But I still ask you to answer on the questions put in issue number 4 and 5, because I missed some of the answers. In your UPR circle, you supported the recommendation to have a comprehensive law on discrimination. And I don't know if you, in the meantime, have adopted a comprehensive legislation on discrimination. If so, we would like to hear that from you, because that is our concern. And in that comprehensive anti-discrimination legislation, we like to have that in the basis on all sphere, also including the private sphere and sexual orientation, and that legislation also provides for an effective administrative and judicial remedy. With regard to racial discrimination, actually, if I look to your national report, that is on paragraph 50 of the report, where there is a complaint received concerning discriminatory acts by ground, and I look at race, then I see there was just one complaint that was in 2008. But I have information that the discrimination on the ground of race is increasing. So maybe you can explain why we just have one case of discrimination in 2008. We also miss in your legislation a definition of racial discrimination. And maybe you have already adopted that definition, then we will hear that from you. Also, there is no criminal sanction on incitement to racial discrimination and acts of racially motivated violence. In your replies to the list of issues in paragraph 8, in the last sentence, which read, "But while acknowledging the need to address racially motivated expressions, there are discussions regarding the constitutional principle of nulla poena sine lege and ways to balance with the freedom of expressions when criminalizing these acts." But we have the expression, the right to freedom of expression in Article 19 of our covenant. But as you know, freedom of expression is not an absolute right. There are limitations, and the limitations are spelled out in paragraph 3 of that article. So, and we also have a general comment on the freedom of expression, and it's general comment number 34. So maybe you can explain that last sentence for us. And then you are also party to the Convention on Elimination of Racial Discrimination. So I would have expected that you had that definition in your legislation, but that is not. So because Mr. Iwasawa has asked almost all the questions I had here, I will stop here for this moment, Mr. Chair, and I thank the delegation in advance for the responses they give. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Wazarval. Thank you. Now I pass the floor to Mr. Yuval Shani. Mr. Shani, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Like my predecessors, I warmly welcome the very large and impressive delegation from the Republic of Korea. I will be dealing today with only two issues, number 9 and number 12, and I will be dealing with some more issues tomorrow. So with respect to issue number 9, which addresses the question of counterterrorism legislation. Before delving into the topic, perhaps I should state the obvious is that, and the obvious is, of course, that the State Party can and, in fact, should take measures to protect public safety and to protect the population of Korea from terror attacks. But it is our position that when the state is engaged in the design and the execution of counterterrorism policies, it must strike a proper balance between the need for security and the need to protect personal liberties, as well as the other values which are reflected in the covenant. Now, in our previous concluding observations for the Republic of Korea in 2006, we expressed concern about receiving insufficient information about existing and proposed counterterrorism legislation, about a lack of definition of what constitutes a terrorism act, and lack of covenant-compliant regulation of important counterterrorism powers, such as interception of communication, searches, detention, and deportation. And we called upon the State Party to address these shortcomings in its legislation. It is somewhat unfortunate that 9 years later, we are meeting again in Geneva, and it appears as if not much has changed in this regard. There is no comprehensive counterterrorism bill that has passed to date. I realize there are a few pending bills before Parliament, but as I said, none has yet passed. And we would like the delegation to first explain to us why does it take the State Party so long to pass the relevant legislation. I understand that these are issues raising political controversy and great sensitivity, but I would expect the State Party perhaps to accept that the current state of affairs, in which these very important policies are not anchored in primary legislation by and large, but rather in piecemeal laws, in some in laws and some in administrative regulations. I'm noting specifically the guidelines on state counterterrorism activities, that this state of affairs is inadequate to address a matter as important as the need to strike a balance between liberty and security and to protect both public safety and ICCPR rights. Can the delegation also provide us with information as to what is the working definition of terrorism that the State Party is currently employing in its activities? Is there any definition in the various bills pending before Parliament that the government of the State Party has endorsed? Whether can you assure us that the various counterterrorism powers that we have requested the State Party to regulate in legislation in manners that are compatible with the covenant are being addressed in the relevant pending bills? Now, it is also our understanding that some of the new bills authorize the National Intelligence Service to designate organizations as terror organizations, and to collect information on the immigration status of individuals belonging to such, bless you, individuals belonging to such organizations, their financial affairs, and their communications. Is this proposal endorsed by the government? And if so, can you explain to us what safeguards are envisioned in order to protect the public from abuse of these very broad powers? The state, the delegation is of course aware to the fact that civil society has made some representations to us, which expressed concern about entrusting such broad powers with the NIA, when the NIS, partly because of the recent scandal concerning its involvement in the 2012 elections, but also I think because of a perception that the NIS already possesses very wide powers of surveillance and data mining, a topic which we will be discussing tomorrow. And finally, on definitions of terrorism, can you also provide us some information as to what is the working definition used by the state party for cyber terrorism? At least one of the draft bills which I saw, the 2013 bill on National Anti-Cyber Terrorism Act, contains an extremely broad definition of what constitutes cyber terrorism, which does not seem to distinguish between politically motivated acts of cybercrime and ordinary cybercrime. So I would appreciate your clarifications in that regard. Now moving to something completely different, which is the protection of individuals deprived of their liberties in mental and psychiatric institutions. I appreciate the information provided to us by the state party, and especially I appreciate the state party's interest in what has been alluded to in the reports as changing the paradigm for dealing with individuals who suffer from mental or severe mental or intellectual disabilities. What I would wish the state to provide us further is information with respect to how it is envisioned that the goal of reducing the number of involuntary hospitalizations would be attained. It is my understanding that the main reforms that are currently considered have to do with improved review of the length of detention in mental health facilities. So it is proposed that the review of the necessity of the detention would be shortened from 6 months to 3 months. And as indicated before by Mr. Kim, the head of the delegation, the Habeas Corpus Act would be expanded so as to introduce an ex officio review of detentions in such facilities. So my questions in this regard is whether these reforms, what is the state of play? Are they about to be passed? Have they been passed already? Please inform us. And while it is important that the state party is taking measures in that direction, the question is whether it would be enough in order to ensure not only that there are not unduly long detentions, but also to ensure that there are no unnecessary detentions in such facilities. I would direct the attention of the state party's delegation to paragraph 19 of our general comment 35, which indicates that detention in mental facilities must be applied only as a measure of last resort. And in this regard, the question that we have is whether the state party's legislation sufficiently incorporates this standard of last resort, and I'm particularly concerned about Article 24, Section 1 of the Mental Health Act, which does appear to suggest that detention in a mental facility could be based simply on the basis of a necessity standard, and not on the basis of threat to harm to oneself or to others. This specific standard is included in the same act, but under a different section, under Article 25 of that act. But Article 24 detentions, which can be authorized with the consent of family members, etc., appear to have a lower threshold, and I invite the state party to offer its observations on the adequacy of legislation in that regard, and also whether the individual in question has a procedural right to appear before an independent authority in order to challenge the decision to deprive him or her of liberty. and whether he or she can be legally represented in such proceedings. So I would appreciate some clarifications on the both on the grounds for deprivation of liberty and also on the procedural safeguards at the moment of deprivation, not after the person has been already institutionalized. And finally, for today, on the conditions of committal in mental institutions, I note again with satisfaction the information provided by the state party about the cessation of the policy of forced sterilizations. And indeed, it appears as if this policy has taken root. I would still appreciate clarification as to whether it would be indeed a crime under Republic of Korea's law to forcefully sterilize a person for mental grounds. And I would also appreciate clarifications as to what measures are in place in order to address repeated reports alleging that the use of restraints and medication for individuals detained in mental institutions is used in an excessive manner. The same goes also for solitary confinements. My main concern in this regard is that the information that we have received from civil society on this point is that the policy of the state party, and I would appreciate if you were correct me if this is not accurate, that the policy of the state party is that the use of constraints and measures of that nature are left for elaboration by internal hospital guidelines, namely that it would be for the institution itself to introduce the guidelines. And our concern is whether the state exercises an adequate degree of supervision over these guidelines and over the implementation of these guidelines. And perhaps, given the sensitivity of this issue, this is also a matter that shouldn't be left to the discretion of private or even public institutions, but should be regulated through primary legislation. So I apologize for the length of my some of the answers, and I look forward to obtain answers from the delegation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shani. The next expert who will take the floor is Ms. Anya Cyberfor. You have the floor, madam.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I would like to join my colleagues in warmly welcoming the distinguished delegation from the Republic of Korea. My issues today are related to the right to life and the prevention of violence in military, and I will try to be as brief as possible in order to give the distinguished delegation enough room to respond to the wealth of our questions. With respect to issue number 10 and the right to life, I would like to raise two issues. First, the death penalty, and the second is the high suicide rate. We have duly taken note of the report as well as the replies, as well as the statement given by the distinguished head of delegation in his opening speech that the death penalty hasn't been executed since the year 1997. Nevertheless, between 2 to 3 death sentences are handed down on average every year. A draft bill on the abolition of the death penalty has been tabled to the National Assembly in July, and I would like to inquire to what extent the government supports this bill. We celebrated, as you may know, last year, the 25th anniversary of the adoption of the second optional protocol to the ICCPR on the abolition of the death penalty, and we would strongly welcome if the Republic of Korea would join the community of states parties which are already parties to this important document. Now, with respect to suicide, I have noted with concern that the state party has the highest suicide rate among OECD countries. The government conducted a fact-finding survey in the year 2013, and I would like to hear more about the root causes of this high suicide rate. It appears that elderly people are particularly affected. Is this because of social pressure or insufficient care facilities? Why did the suicide rate among women increase so that it is now the second cause of death among women in the state party? Also, what concrete steps have been taken under the 5-year basic plan for suicide prevention and the Act for the Prevention of Suicide and the creation of culture of respect for life? I turn now to issue number 13, which is about the violence and abuse in the military. The replies by the state party recognize that cruel acts and sexual crimes occur frequently within the military. The Ministry of Defense reported more than 17,000 incidents of beatings or brutal treatment in the year 2013. The replies state that currently there is legislative action to criminalize violence inside barracks and that this legislation is in progress. Does this mean that as of now it is not adequately punishable yet under the current law? How many of the reported cases led to criminal sentences, I would like to know. Could you please provide statistics on the sanctions imposed? We have received information according to which only 1.5% of the cases lead to an imprisonment. I would also like to inquire about the causes for the violence and sexual crimes in the military. I duly recognize that there have been steps already been taken in order to prevent ill treatment in the military, and I won't list again what has been stated in the replies, but I would like to know when will the state party review the effectiveness of these preventive mechanisms and to see whether this problem is adequately addressed. Finally, we have received information according to which the military imprisonment as a disciplinary measure raises concerns of arbitrary confinement. Which safeguards is in place, I would like to know, to ensure that military prison system complies with Articles 9 and 14 of the Covenant. This already brings me to the end of my questions for today. I would look forward to receiving the answers. Thank you for giving me the floor, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Saber. Okay, I don't see another member of the committee, so it's time for doing a break. Vamos a hacer una pausa.
We're going to take a break now for 20 minutes so that the delegation can prepare their replies. We know that's very little time, but it is the time that we have to give so that we can carry out the dialogue as we need to. We will therefore come back at 4:45 in order to continue to hear the replies to the committee members' questions. The session is adjourned.